Hi, my name is Jordan Elm, and I'm Associate Professor of Biostatistics at the Medical University of South Carolina. And I'm going to be talking about the importance of advanced statistics in clinical trials today. So a statistician always starts with a very good understanding of the study design. That is absolutely key. An understanding of how the data are going to be collected and measured, as well as the expected amount of missing data and non-compliance. And all of the analyses should be pre-planned and recorded in a statistical analysis plan. This can help to ensure that the statistical analysis is valid, but it can't make up for a poorly designed and conducted study. Some of the things that go in a statistical analysis plan are as follows. So a pre-planned analysis plan should be prepared at the start of the study, or failing that, at least prior to unblinding to the treatment effect. But it will often need to be updated if the protocol is amended or to adjust for challenges in the conduct of the trial as they arise. There are often a variety of choices that a statistician can choose in which to analyze the data. So having a very detailed statistical analysis plan will minimize the statistician's biases. It will pre-specify the prioritization of outcomes, what is primary, what is a secondary outcome, et cetera. It should state the significance level that will be used for conclusions, as well as approaches to multiple comparisons. And it should define what analysis samples you're going to be analyzing. So is it going to be the intent to treat analysis? Will you be doing a per protocol analysis, et cetera? Those should be very clearly defined. Handling missing data, how that's going to be done. And if there are any plans for interim analyses, those should be described. And then if there's going to be any model building, the planned approaches to those should be well defined, as well as adjustments for baseline covariates. So let's talk specifically about challenges for studies examining metabolism-based therapies. Well, the number one, top one, is not being able to do double-blinded studies. So I'm going to talk about how that impacts the analysis, but mostly I'm going to focus on compliance or non-compliance, as well as the longitudinal follow-up and the impact that that has on dropouts and how to handle missing data. So the least biased analysis that can be done is an intent-to-treat analysis. And an intent-to-treat analysis is one that follows the intent-to-treat principle, which is a comparison of treatment policies. Subjects' data are analyzed in the group to which they are randomized, regardless of whether they comply with the protocol or actually receive the study drug to which they were allocated. This preserves the benefits of randomization, because if you analyze patients in a group different to which they were randomized, you're essentially undoing randomization. And we all know how important randomization is. But our sample size calculations need to account for noncompliance. So a basic sample size calculation will involve four things: your significance level or alpha, your type two error rate or your power, of the variance of the outcome that you're measuring, and then the clinically relevant effect size. But we need to actually inflate this basic sample size calculation for non-compliance, and that involves an inflation factor that depends on the expected amount of patients that are going to switch from the intervention to receiving the control or just simply dropping out of the study, and also the expected proportion of patients that are going to switch from control to intervention. Now, in some studies, that's not possible, but in many studies, it is. So we need to think about how likely that is to happen. And then once we have those expected proportions, we can calculate this inflation factor, which is 1 over, in the denominator, 1 minus those two proportions squared. So it ends up being quite a large inflation, but this compensates for the dilution of the treatment effect that happens when you have treatment noncompliance. So the easiest way to understand the dilution of the treatment effect is to look at an example. So suppose that you're studying weight change as your outcome in two groups, and the expected mean weight loss is 30 pounds in group A and 20 pounds in group B, or a difference of 10. You would have 80% power to detect this type of difference with a sample size of 126 using our basic sample size calculation. But now let's assume that we are anticipating a certain amount of drop in or drop out, crossovers, if you will, in the two different groups of as much as 15% in group A and 25% in group B. The dilution of the treatment effect is actually based on the fact that 15% of the subjects in group A are going to look like the expected mean for group B, and vice versa, 25% in group B will actually look like they have an expected mean weight loss of 30 pounds. So this dilutes, if you calculate that, it's the average of those two, and it dilutes your treatment difference down to 6. So if we were to have accounted for this at the beginning of the study, we would use our inflation factor, 1 minus 15.15 minus 0.25 squared. That gives us an inflation of almost 3. And so our new sample size, or total sample size, for an intent to treat analysis would, rather than 126, becomes 350. So it's quite a large inflation. And it's important not to forget to do that. I want to talk now about missing data, because missing data is the bane of every researcher's existence, but a carefully designed study protocol will take great pains to minimize missing data. But regardless of that, some missing data is often inevitable, but hopefully it'll be a small proportion. So there are a number of ways to impute missing data, but nothing is absolutely perfect. Some ways are actually better than others. So let's talk about some of the more popular choices. Last observation carried forward, or last value carried forward, is when you fill in the last observation that you had as if it were the final value. But that can be quite biased in certain situations. And so there are other options, such as the best worst case method, where you have assigned the best observed value to missing data in the placebo group and the worst observed value to missing data in the active group. The mean imputation is simply to substitute the missing data with the mean of all observed values within the group, or using a regression imputation in which you replace missing observations with a predicted value from a regression model. So all of these methods are what we call single point imputation. You're assuming that once you've filled in that data, that data is then known and true. But a better approach is something called multiple imputation. And this is really kind of considered the gold standard for imputing data. So what we do here is we use a modeling approach to repeatedly impute the missing cases and then replace each of those missing values by more than one imputed value. So in essence, we're creating multiple complete data sets, usually at least 5, but it can be more. And the analysis is then performed multiple times on this multiple data set. And so the inference needs to be combined. It's a bit harder to implement, which is one reason why people often default to some of those simpler methods that I talked about, but it is a much better method. I also now want to talk about mixed models because of the longitudinal data in this area. This is a great tool. So mixed model is the nickname for what we call a mixed effect model, which is simply an extension of simple linear regression. So it includes both a fixed and random effects, hence the name mixed. The fixed effects are just our usual things like treatment indicator, baseline covariates, etc. But the random effect is what allows us to model the correlation that exists within the data. So that might be random repeated measures amongst the same subjects, or it could be some type of clustering, such as patients who are enrolled within the same site. The nice thing about mixed models is that they don't require constant time intervals of measurement across patients, although that is very helpful. But it will allow us to use all the available information. So just because the patient doesn't have all of their observations, they don't automatically get thrown out of the model the way some other types of analyses do. So because of this, it is a type of implicit imputation. You aren't explicitly filling in the values, but you are modeling using all the data that that subject has. So it is another nice way of handling your missing data. It also allows you to have patient-specific covariates in the model at the same time, so it's quite useful. And then I want to talk a return to this topic of the double blinding and the impact on the analyses. So with interim analyses and adaptations, the most important thing is that those be pre-specified, and they need to have an adjustment for the fact that you're looking at your data multiple times, because if you don't adjust the significance level for that, you're increasing your false positive rate. So the rules for termination of the trial early, or changes to the trial, adaptations, if you will, need to be very clearly defined in the study protocol or in the statistical analysis plan. And because the study is unblinded, you need to consider how that's going to impact the trial moving forward so that it doesn't bias the recruitment or the way that patients are treated after the interim results are known. So we need to be very careful about who knows the results of the interim analysis. And that should really be an independent group, such as the DSMB and an unblinded statistician that keeps that information confidential. Because if not, the investigators can guess that there is efficacy if the trial didn't stop or if there's some type of change. So we have to be very careful about the messaging for changes moving forward. So in summary, in order to have a valid statistical inference, the number one key thing is to have a well-designed study. And then we need to have a statistical analysis plan that's consistent with the hypotheses of interest and the sample size that accounts for dropouts and noncompliance. And all patients should be accounted for in the analysis. So there needs to be ideally an intent to treat analysis that has a methodology in order to handle missing data, which is acceptable. And then any type of adaptations or interim analyses ought to be pre-specified.